AOP is applied to that particular water, right? It should not be mostly reacting with the components in the water, or through that reactions, you know, generate other side products that we do not want. Number four, this AOP needs to achieve good treatment efficiency and energy efficiency. So number four is with the idea that we want to basically achieve the objective of treatment, but use as little energy as possible, right? And so these are the four objectives that an effective AOP should deliver. So for the number one objective, you know, understanding the reaction kinetics is key. So we need to understand what the, you know, radical species are generated by the AOP and what it can degrade and at what rate. This is very important. Number two is we need to, for the second objective, is we need to understand the reaction pathway and mechanism. So we need to know what kind of transformation products are being formed, and then we can evaluate whether the products are toxic or not. And number three, you know, to be the objective three is that we need to evaluate the water matrix effect. And number four includes the how do we optimize the AOP so we can have energy efficiency. And also there's more an engineering challenge about scaling up. How do you take from a laboratory scale prototype to a, you know, full scale application? This involves a lot of engineering design and optimization to achieve treatment efficiency and energy efficiency. So I'm going to focus on UV-based AOPs because that's where we have most of the experience with and have done most of the research. UV-based AOP, meaning that UV light is the activator. It provides the energy to produce for the radical production. And there are many different types of UV-based AOP. So as you can see from the very common, you know, UVH2O2, UV ozone, and then UV persulfate, UV chlorine, UV peracetic acid, or UV titanium dioxide, right? And then UV catalyst, that's not titanium dioxide. There are many new ones that are being developed. And so these first five are the homogeneous system. That these guys involving the catalyst are heterogeneous systems. I'm going to focus on the homogeneous systems because in drinking water and municipal wastewater treatment, mostly it's homogeneous systems are being used. And you know that, as you can see from these reaction here, the UV-based AOP is to produce radicals. And the radicals are powerful oxidants that can degrade the micropollutants or kill disease-transmitting microorganisms. The older AOPs, UV AOPs, produce a hydroxyl radical, like UVH2O2 and UV ozone. UV persulfate is the newer. It produces a sulfate radical and hydroxyl radical. UV chlorine produces chlorine radical and OH radical. UV peracetic acid produces OH radical and this CH3COO, this carbon centered radicals. Okay. So that's what I kind of want to point out, that as we use newer and newer UV-based AOP, we know that it produces the radicals that we have pretty good amount of knowledge, like hydroxyl radical. However, there are other radicals that also could be generated with these, you know, newer or other options of UV AOP. So for example, UV chlorine, we know that it produces OH radical and chlorine radical, or sometimes this is called chlorine atom. But it's not only these two radicals. There are other chlorine-related radicals that could be formed, and they could also be a pretty effective oxidant. UVPAA not only produces these two radicals, there are other carbon-based radicals that could be produced under the UVPAA. So as we use additional choices of a UV-based AOP, the radical chemistry probably is more complicated. And now we have primary and additional radicals. Their reactivity needs to be understood. And then also when we apply AOP in a real water, you know, real water definitely is not only contain the contaminants we want to treat, but also have many, many other things, right? And so for example, let's say we apply something as simple as UVH202 to produce OH radical. There are many other things also present in water that they can also react with OH radical. So we call these as scavengers. So these scavengers react with the OH radical, then overall reduce the concentration of OH radical. So that affects the performance of this AOP in terms of degrading the contaminants we want to treat. And then besides being a scavenger, you know, all these other components in water, these other components like chlorine, bicarbonate and ammonia, they could also react with our primary radicals and react with OH radical or sulfate radical to produce secondary radicals, right? So chlorine radicals, carbonate radical, and ammonia radicals. And these secondary radicals, you know, often are present at significant concentration depending on the water conditions. And these other secondary radicals could actually end up to be the major radicals that are doing the AOP, you know, not the OH radical that we are, you know, intended to generate. And so these different radical species has different oxidation potential, and they may have different selectivity in terms of how they react with different organic compounds. So all these needs to be, you know, understood. And so in my presentation today, and I'm going to kind of quickly give you several cases that we have done for the four different UV AOP, so UV hydrogen peroxide, UV persulfate, UV chlorine, and UV peracetic acid. We have mostly conducted batch reactions, so our reaction setup is not complicated at all. Sometimes the light is on the side, light source, or from the top. Most of the time we use low pressure UV lamp, so 254 nanometer is the radiation. And we use different analytical techniques to measure the parent compound degradation or the intermediate or byproduct formation. We also use kinetic modeling to help to estimate or calculate the concentration of the radicals that will be formed under a certain AOP to help us understand the experimental outcome. So I divided my work, you know, and then put it into three parts in this presentation. So hopefully I have enough time to say all that. So for the part one is we are comparing UVH202 and UV persulfate. And for these two AOP, we have applied them to the case of for degrade pharmaceuticals in urine, and then also for inactivation of pathogens. Okay. So you know, first one, I'll start with the first one here. Is we try to degrade pharmaceutical in urine and using these two AOP. So first of all, is why do we want to degrade pharmaceuticals in urine? Because as you know, that most of the pharmaceuticals in the environment is come from the excretion from human, right? So you take medicines, and then most of the drugs you take actually are excreted in urine or feces, and they enter the municipal wastewater, you know, and they don't get removed effectively at municipal wastewater treatment plant, and they end up to be the surface water. And so, but when you look at the municipal wastewater, urine contributes about only 1% in volume for the entire municipal wastewater. But urine contributes to more than 90%, actually, you know, depends, 60 to 90% of pharmaceuticals to the municipal wastewater. And so our idea was it will be much more advantageous if we treat the pharmaceutical at the urine stage. Number one, you treat a much smaller volume, and then the pharmaceutical concentration will be a lot higher, and that will be easier to treat compared to when they are very diluted. And then secondly is there is an increasing interest in terms of recover nutrients from urine, right? Urine has a very high concentration of nitrogen and phosphorus. These are very viable nutrients. And so there's this, you know, trend of green infrastructures to try to design separation, you know, of urine from the rest of the wastewater. And then that urine can undergo nutrient recovery. And we think that that will be a great opportunity to do my pharmaceutical control as well. So that's our motivation about why we're doing this. So now, treating pharmaceuticals in urine, this urine is different from municipal wastewater or from river water or lake water. So urine is mostly, you know, after leaving your body, after a couple hours, natural pH has become 9. And besides, the pH is a bit higher, it also contains very high concentration of chloride, bicarbonate, and ammonia. Okay. And so you see the concentration of these components. These are much higher, actually, compared to municipal wastewater. And so these components will have an impact on whatever the treatment processes you want to apply in the urine. They have to be considered. So I just want to show you that we pick 3 different pharmaceuticals as our representative. And then using these 2 AOP to try to degrade these pharmaceuticals in urine matrix. And then we monitor the compound degradation and then get the decay rate constant. Okay, and so we are plotting the rate constants here. And this part is for the UVH2O2. This is UV persulfate. And we use 2 different type of water. This is a phosphate buffer. We set a pH 9. So this represents clean water. And then we have hydrolyzed urine, okay? And so you can clearly see that for the 3 compounds in the clean water, the rate constants are high, right? But once you apply that in the hydrolyzed urine, the rate constants become lower or significantly lower. And actually for the second compound here, this acetyl sulfamethoxazole, this is, so sulfamethoxazole is an antibiotic commonly prescribed. And then it actually excreted from human in this form, acetylated SMX. And actually, the acetylated SMX cannot be degraded by the AOP at all in the urine matrix. And that's why we don't have rate constants here. Rate constants is 0. Okay, so the AOP works to some degree, or it doesn't work at all for one of the compound. And the performance is a lot worse in the hydrolyzed urine compared to clean water. Why? Because there are many other things in the urine that serve as a scavenger. Okay. So we conduct the kinetic modeling to try to calculate the concentration of radicals in the clean water and also in the urine system. And then based on the radicals calculation, we understood why the performance is a lot lower in the urine matrix. As you can see, if we apply UVH2O2 in the clean water, this will be an OH radical concentration. But in the hydrolyzed urine, the OH radical concentration is much lower. Instead, most of the radical, most significant radical is carbonate radical, because carbonate can react with OH radical. If we apply UV persulfate in the clean water, this is a sulfate radical and OH radical concentration. But the concentration become much lower in hydrolyzed urine, and carbonate radical again is the dominant radical. And because the type of radical and the radical concentration have changed, so we have seen the different performance. So I'm just going to quickly highlight that with the dominant radical to be the carbonate radical, let's say this is the case that we have take the phosphate buffer, spiked in extra amount of bicarbonate, and mostly generate the carbonate radical. This is all from our calculation, okay? But the point I wanted to show you is that the carbonate radical can react with SMX, but cannot react with this compound. So that's because this functional group is very important to react with carbonate radical. Once we change this functional group to be derivatized like this, this functional group is no longer reactive with carbonate radical. Okay. So we compare these two AOPs side by side, and we compare that their performance in different water matrix condition. So I've shown you the phosphate buffer, the clean water, and then also within the phosphate buffer, we spiked in the urine component, you know, individually or as a pair. And then the last one here, this is the synthetic hydrolyzed urine matrix in which we spiked all the components into the matrix. So overall, in general, you can see the rate constants decrease as the water matrix becomes more complicated because of increasing scavenging effect. But if we just, for the comparison of these two AOP, clearly UV persulfate is better than UV H2O2. As you can see, the rate constants are higher on this end. Like bicarbonate does not affect the UV persulfate as badly as the UV hydrogen peroxide. So we also certainly have done some work to look at what kind of transformation products are formed after this AOP treatment. And I'm just mentioning this very briefly. So if it's mostly by OH radical, then this is the major product. For the persulfate, sulfate radical, these are two other major products. So hydroxylation and carbonylation. And with the carbonyl radical to be the main actor, then these two are also the main products. Okay, so the different dominant radicals could also change the dominant transformation products that are formed. Okay, and then so let me move on to talk about we are apply these two AOP for disinfection. So for this work, then we chose three different microorganisms. We chose E. coli as a representative for bacteria, bacteriophage MS2 to represent virus, and bacillus spores to represent protozoa, and then apply UV H2O2 or UV persulfate for their inactivation. So here is to look at the disinfection. So disinfection is normally presented by the survival rate. So this is based on the organism's population, right? So if it presented by the end population divided by initial population in the log, you know, present way. So one log of reduction meaning population is decreased by tenfold, right? Four log reduction is decreased by 10,000-fold. So usually disinfection, the goal is for four log of reduction, okay? And so for the three different organisms, and then the UV only and UV AOP option. So you can see the results, you know, varies. For E. coli, AOP slightly improved the disinfection compared to UV only. For virus, UV H2O2 significantly improved the inactivation. And then UV persulfate also improving activation. For the spores, only H2O2 slightly improved the disinfection. So AOP is good, but good for certain cases, right? It's not good for all of them. It certainly is very good for MS2, for virus inactivation. Okay. And then, so, you know, the disinfection results definitely vary depending on the types of AOP and depending on the type of organisms. And the outcome is different is probably because the different radicals are formed, right? So we want to get a better understanding about which radicals, right, really have the disinfection potential, the capability. And so how do we understand that, you know? So when we apply UV H2O2, we understand that we are generating OH radical. But in fact, that there's dissolved CO2 in our system because the ambient air has CO2, right? And so the OH radical can react with dissolved CO2, forming carbonate radical. OH radical can also react with H2O2 that we have applied in the system to produce superoxide radical. So we generally, when we apply AOP, we are generating a suite of radical species, not just one. And so, but which radical really is doing the killing? You know, all of them or only some of them? So how do we know that? And UV persulfate also generate a hydroxyl radical, sulfate radical, and then because these reactions are possible, also could have carbonate radical and superoxide radical. So we developed the different experimental strategies. Basically, so we can change the oxidants and then use different kind of quencher to manipulate our experimental conditions so that this, you know, under that particular experimental condition, we can create a radical at a concentration much higher than the other radicals. Okay, so we can have one radical that is dominant in concentrations compared to other radicals. So if you kind of just quickly show that UVH2O2, this is based on our calculation, OH radical, carbonate radical, superoxide radical are all pretty significant in concentration. But we can add the bicarbonate to the system where we can create a carbonate radical dominant system. Okay. For example, UV persulfate, we have hydroxyl radical and sulfate radical are important. But we can add a TBA into the UV persulfate system to create a sulfate radical dominant system. So basically, using those kind of experimental, you know, manipulations, we can create a system that one of the radical is dominant in concentration. And then we you know, subject the microorganism to those systems to see whether they're inactivated or not. And so this is the results. So we have the sulfate radical dominant system, carbonate radical dominant, or superoxide radical dominant systems. And then we compare that without the radical is the first column here. And this, for each pair, this is three different organisms, right? For each pair, the first data point is inactivation by UV only. And then the second column is the inactivation by the dominant radical. And so if the two bars are similar, meaning that the sulfate radical doesn't really inactivate E. coli, but it can inactivate MS2. Okay? So basically, sulfate radical can inactivate MS2, carbonate radical can inactivate E. coli and MS2, and then superoxide radical cannot inactivate any of the microorganisms through this experimental study. So in conclusion, we find that hydroxyl radical, sulfate radical, and carbonate radical can inactivate pathogens, but superoxide radical cannot. And then we actually, not only we understand which radical can inactivate microorganisms, we want to be able to predict the disinfections in a quantitative way. And so, as you can see that when we apply AOP, we have UV, and then we have an oxidant, right? Radicals are formed. And what we observe experimentally is the overall disinfection of microorganisms. This overall disinfection is due to disinfection by UV alone, and also disinfection by the radical species. Disinfection by the radical species is related to the concentration radical multiplied by the exposure time. So this is so-called the CT value, CT concept, concentration multiplied by exposure time. Okay. So we did some additional experiments to get the CT profile of the disinfection. So for example, for hydroxyl radical, for the three different microorganisms, this is the CT profile. So you can see that for MS2, this is the CT profile. This is the open circle here. So if I wanted to achieve 2 log of reduction, I need to provide this amount of CT. The concentration and exposure time has to achieve that CT value. If I want to achieve 4 log reduction, I have to provide this amount of CT value. For the E. coli, then I have to provide much higher CT value, etc. And so this CT value is very useful because we can put it back to this equation based on whatever the CT that we provide to the system to predict what will be the log of reduction that's caused by that radical. Okay. And so that's why we are ready to do the disinfection in the real water matrix. So in the real water, we have done the E. coli and MS2 in the surface water and the wastewater. And so in the surface water, of course, this is not our clean water now. Surface water or wastewater has DOC, dissolved inorganic species, nitrate sulfate, chloride, etc. And so we can include those information into our kinetic model. And then we can then, based on the surface water or wastewater condition, to predict this is the concentration radicals that will be, like concentration OH radical, that could be generated in the surface water. And then we multiply by the exposure time, so we do the experiments for the different time of disinfection, then we get the CT value. The CT value used the previous equation that I showed you, that I can predict what will be the log of reduction that I can achieve. And so the data points here are from our experiments, and the lines here are from our model prediction, as I show you based on this previous equations here. And so our model actually agree with the experimental data pretty well, indicating the model is reasonably good. And then, so what does these results actually mean here? So you can see that for E. coli in the surface water, using UV only or AOP, in general, the disinfection efficiency is about the same. There's really no benefit of using AOP here for E. coli. And then for the MS2, compared to UV only, AOP is still much better in terms of inactivation. Okay. In the wastewater, the E. coli story is the same, and then the MS2, the AOP is similar to UV only now. So the benefit of AOP is no longer, significant in the wastewater matrix, okay? So the AOP, shows benefit for the MS2 in the surface water, but not so in the wastewater. It's just because there's greater scavenging effect in the wastewater. So for the dose of the oxidant and the UV intensity that we apply here, we see that it's beneficial to apply in the surface water, but it's probably useless to apply in the wastewater, Okay. But this experiment basically tells us that it is still beneficial to upgrade the system to UV AOP if we want to disinfect virus, right? It is still a better disinfection efficiency, AOP, compared to UV only. Okay. And then we did some cost-effective analysis. This part is to try, now we determine that it is beneficial to use UV AOP to disinfect virus in surface water. But how do we achieve the disinfection using the most efficient, energy-efficient way to do that? We can change how much UV dose, right, and how much oxidant dose we want to apply. And this type of cost-effective analysis helps us to determine that. So I'll just focus on this. There's different way to do the cost-effective analysis. I'll just focus on the EEO here. EEO is the electric energy to achieve one order of inactivation, right? So per order of inactivation, per order of a cell population decrease, we want to use as low energy as possible, right? So we want the EEO number to be as low as possible. And then we basically can, based on the different, so we have two parameters that we can manipulate when we apply AOP. You can control how much UV you want to use, right? Number of lights, length, and then how much oxidant dose you want to use, right? And then the calculation, we can then predict the OH radical or other relevant radical generation, then predict the disinfection efficiency, right? And then also using the EEO concept to estimate the energy cost. So this is the results that showing in the graph representation. So the color here represent EEO number, the energy. So the warmer the color means the higher energy, the cooler the color means lower energy. And the solid line here means log of reduction for our disinfection. So our goal, let's say, is a 4 log of reduction. So we follow this contour, this black line here. And you can see that if I don't use AOP, just UV only, then this black line is right here, right, in the red zone. So the energy is very high. But if I'm just adding a little bit of H2O2, I can be at this area. This energy is much lower. I still achieve full log reduction, but use much less energy. And so basically, the calculation shows that if we change from UV only to UV AOP, we can save about 75% of energy to achieve the same log of inactivation for the pathogen, for the virus. Okay. So let me just conclude this one part one here. So we use these two AOP to try to degrade pharmaceuticals in urine. We see that we saw a very significant matrix scavenging effect. And we saw that the other radical species become dominant and then really affect the results. UV persulfate appears to be better than UVH2O2 in this urine matrix. For the disinfection, then we see that the MS2 or the virus is particularly a good target for the AOP disinfection. And hydroxyl radical has a very strong disinfection ability towards virus, and then followed by sulfate radical and then carbonate radical. So let me move on to talk about part two, okay? So part two, I want to briefly talk about some work we did on the UV chlorine, okay? So combining UV and chlorine is becoming increasingly, you know, of interest for some of the pilot full-scale plants in the United States. And that's because chlorine is already used in most of the plants. And so they can, you know, if they want to look at the AOP option, they want to see that if I just add a UV and then combine that chlorine together, then, you know, whether that's a beneficial or not. So for the research that we have done on the UV chlorine, we look at this example is pharmaceuticals degradation in swimming pool water. Swimming pool, as you know, that all of you have been to swimming pools, right? Mm-hmm. And you can smell a lot of chlorine, right?
Yes.
For sure. You can smell a lot of chlorine. And so we actually did the UV chlorine and also sunlight chlorine. And so if you go to an outdoor swimming pool, there's a lot of chlorine in the water, right? And then the sunlight. So of course, naturally, there's a sunlight chlorine AOP process. But indoor pool also could have UV chlorine condition. Because not only they use chlorine to treat the swimming pool water, UV is one of a very common process to use to remove chloramines in swimming pool water. And so when you add the chlorine to the pool water, and there's ammonia in the water, so forming chloramines. And chloramines could be volatile, you know, so the indoor air could have high concentration of chloramine, and chloramine could be very harmful to people who have asthma, or some people actually get really sick by breathing too much of chloramine. And so UV, chloramine can photodegrade by UV light. And so they can use UV as a process to control the concentration of chloramine in the pool.